My name is Lynette Young, and I run a community online called Women in Google Plus, and you can find a website, and you can find a page in Google Plus, or you can follow me somehow on Google Plus, Google Lynette Radio, or Lynette Young. I forgot, yeah, because you're supposed to use legal names or common names.
Yes.
So I had to switch from Lynette Radio, which is how everybody else kind of sort of knows me, to Lynette Young, which is a name I borrowed from my husband when I married him. But I actually want to talk today about all of the Aliza is one of the people.
You said it again.
I said it again. Oh my gosh! Why am I Aliza? Why am I never? Because there's no E's in there. I'm gonna.
Okay.
Aliza's
so
name.
So here's the thing. So here's the thing. What's really funny.
I'm gonna spell your name wrong on my paper, so I get it right.
Yeah, I usually spell it U H L E E Z U H, so people know how to pronounce it.
I'm gonna. Yeah, I actually wrote it down exactly like that because I'm like that's how it sounds, but I want to say it. Okay. Well, you can introduce yourself since I'm apparently bombing like in the worst possible way. Because we were saying just before on texting or on the comments that I've seen you at conferences and I'm always so nervous to meet you. And now apparently, my foot is really in my mouth. So I'm gonna let you introduce yourself and then we'll have a conversation so I don't look like an idiot anymore.
Well, first, I have to tell you, everybody mispronounces my name. It seems like this universal thing. And I also noticed when I was with my co-author, Danielle Smith, for one of the books that I've written, Mom Incorporated, she and I were interviewed, and as soon as I corrected the interviewer, it just, everything got totally discombobulated. I didn't mean to do that to you. And it's okay. I'll respond to anything. So am I supposed to introduce myself now?
Yes.
Hello, I'm Aliza Sherman, and I'm the original Cybergrrl. I've been online since 1987.
You gotta remember,
which is true.
Right?
Which is true. And I am a digital strategist, an author, a keynote speaker. I travel around the country and around the world talking about the internet, and often about the internet and women's issues surrounding technology and the web. So I also speak about a lot of other topics and write about a lot of other topics, but I've been watching what you're doing with Women of G+, and I think it's terrific. Thank you very much for having me here.
Well, thank you. You are definitely a pioneer for women in the online and digital space. And, I mean, every time I've ever seen you at a conference, you are constantly, you've got this great MO. We were chatting about this a little bit before. You wear this tiara, and you have this hot pink boa, and you have wine.
All the time. Oh, wait a minute. Okay, not all the time.
Okay, not tiara, all the time.
Tiara and boa most of the time.
Most of the time.
Wine some of the time. The good times.
Good times. Well, yeah, not on the stage, per se, but, you know, I've seen you. Usually yes. When I wind up bumping into you or being in the same place, we're at, like, a social function or something. But
yes, then I have wine.
And you have wine. Because that's mm-hmm. kind of the thing to do. That or Red Bull, which would be me.
Oh, yeah, that's not me. I would not do well on Red Bull.
I do extremely well on Red Bull. But part of it is like, to be honest, like I first saw you, and I knew you had something to do with women and technology online. And then you're just, like, surrounded by all these amazing people, because you kind of tell who everybody was. I was like, okay, I need to know more about her. And then I would kind of go and look you up, and you were all over Twitter, and you're all over everywhere. And I was just like, wow, what a great role model, because you've been in this and cognizant of the need to help other women not propel themselves, but I guess kind of use their voice online. And that's, I know, some of the titles of the talks that you do about women finding their voices and things like that. And I just think it's really good. And I part of the reason that I grabbed you and you were like, oh, I'll come and do a hangout. And I was like, this would be awesome. But I kind of want to know your views on why you started out. I mean, you said like 87, right? I think I started in 89. Hmm. But like, what drove you to do this so early back then? Because I was in technology then too, and I was kind of gender blind. I was like, okay, it's me and 40 men. What are you going to do? But what drove you to start your whole journey with women in technology and women online?
Well, in 1987, I was not a techie. I fancied myself a writer. I had never submitted any of my writing before, but I bought my first computer with the goal of typing up and printing out my manuscripts, because I wrote them all in spiral notebooks with pen and paper. So I bought an Amstrad 1640 and a dot matrix printer. And she's nodding, like the geek girl's going, yeah, I know what you're talking about. And yeah. Well, at all. Okay, I want to hear you imitate modem sound, the handshake. So the person who helped me buy this computer said, well, why don't you get a modem and I'll show you how to go online. And external modem, extremely slow, very noisy. Going online at the time was local BBSs, bulletin board systems, and he connected my computer for me, showed me all of the ins and outs of computing at the time, which at the time were dual floppies, no hard drive really. Put in one, put in the other, booting it up. So I basically played games on it. And that was my introduction. So here I was a writer. I was typing, and I knew how to type, and I was learning about these BBSs. And I like to tell the story of one night, I'm on my computer, and Audie, my sister, and my roommates are totally worried about me. They think I've gone off the deep end, because they have no idea what this stuff is. And I am in a BBS. Suddenly this message pops up on the screen and says, do you want to chat? Now, war games, if you remember. And so I'm thinking to myself, this is the computer coming to life. I mean, I really am totally into sci-fi. So that was the thing. I wasn't into technology, but from a young age, I've been reading Ray Bradbury, and then I got into cyberpunk. And so sci-fi was in my brain. So I was totally sure that my computer had come alive, but it turns out it was a 17-year-old boy from Brooklyn who was connected to the same BBS. Now, everyone who's using the internet today who is in their 20s, for example, you don't remember not having interconnectedness. And back then, it was shocking, and it was a revelation. Now it's commonplace, but back then it was science fiction. So that was my early experiences, not as a techie. So I continually come at technology from a writing standpoint, a communication standpoint, and a connection. I'm not really thinking about the machine. I'm thinking about the people on the other end of the machine. So that's how I got involved in it, and the ideas behind Cybergrrl just came out of me as a woman starting a company for the first time, an internet company, and there were no other women starting internet companies at that time, at least none that I could find, and then just finding other women who at least knew what the internet was about, and banding together and thinking, I found my tribe, although back then we didn't call it tribe. Mm-hmm. Back then, I called them Webgrrls, and I was Cybergrrl. So that evolved, and that was the early 90s, so that was already a couple of years after I had already had my secret little hobby called the internet.
That's awesome. My first handle online, besides my numbers, I don't remember, was it Prodigy that had the numbers, or was it CompuServe?
CompuServe had the numbers.
Because I have that written down someplace, but my first like real word was PC chick. Of course, now I'm a Mac girl.
I was PC chick, and now you're a Mac girl.
Yeah, that's what I was. That was my first handle. It was PC chick because I was a
network
administrator.
We were all on PCs. Yeah. We were all on PCs unless we were totally lucky to get something early on Mac. But I was NYC writer. And everyone would say, how did you get that name without any numbers at the end? That was AOL, of course. But AOL back then was the underdog. That was the small service, and that was one of my first forays into a larger system, commercial online services, as they were called back then. And I was NYC writer specifically because of the harassment that was going on, especially back then. If you identified yourself publicly as female, then you were an instant target for people wanting to harass you. So I was very gender neutral with my name, never had any trouble, and learned later that a lot of the early people I interacted with who I thought were women were actually men posing as women, which I found fascinating. These are different times, but you still obviously have the identity thing going on, and I don't ever feel like there's harassment running rampant anymore. Mm-hmm. It just depends on where you are and the topic at hand, I think.
Yeah, I'm sure there's pockets everywhere. It doesn't really matter. Sure. It's not one platform prevalent than the other, depending on, you know, the ecosystem of who's running in there. But yeah, just thinking back, and I was like, yeah, I used PC Chicken. It was brutal. Brutal. And I was used to it every day in my work anyway. And for those people, I was like, oh, just turn it off. I don't really care. Because there was this a strong sense of detachment to people that you didn't form relationships with. But now if something happens, you know, to me there's more concern, I guess, now, because some people don't understand the boundaries of the web or the lack of boundaries with the web. But back then, yeah, I would personally get harassment and crazy things sent to me. And I was like, yeah, whatever. Clothes didn't exist anymore.
Yeah. There was a bit of unreality to it, I think. There was a bit of that detachment because a lot of us didn't even understand the idea that we're making these contacts and connections with all of these different people. I mean, I was very oblivious. I had no idea there were other people on the same service as I was on. And when I finally did, you begin to either really gravitate toward it or reject it. And I remember really gravitating toward it. My whole moniker, Cybergrrl, came out of cyberspace, William Gibson, neuromancer. So to me, I was immersing myself into this space. And I accepted and felt very, very connected to other people. Whereas the anonymity piece of it allowed a lot of people to be very removed and disconnected. I think that certain people and the way their brains work, it didn't really compute. And now I think that our brains have changed, which is why we seem to have such facility with all of this now. Not everybody, but I have to say from the start, though, I really have always felt super connected once I realized there were other people there. I wanted to make those connections and then to connect the people with one another. So if I knew people over here and people over here, I wanted them to know each other. And one of the very first things I did, which is so primitive, but this is all we had, when I was on America Online and I was meeting other women, I thought, well, we should network. So I created the women's list, and it was essentially an email where I listed all the women I was meeting. And I asked them to tell me about themselves and if they're looking for something in a job or somebody to work with them on a project, what did they do and how could they help one another. And I would type this all out and compile it and mail it out to everyone, email it out to everybody. And that was our way of networking with each other, is by looking through this email to find someone to connect with. So that was my early – and then I learned what listservs were.
I was writing cocktail recipe pieces of software. That's what I wound up doing online.
Cocktail as in beverage cocktail?
Beverages cocktail, yes. But, you know, the funny thing is, and I will never, ever speak in absolutes, but I'm going to say this. I know I just did. My husband walked out of the room. I see that a lot of women that I wind up talking to that are passionate and very highly engaged in this, you know, in what some would consider technology, especially back then, because you had to have a head for this, even though you came at this from a writer, your perspective of this didn't end the screen in front of you. You were thinking about the human and the people. And I see that a lot with people, or with women in general, when they're doing networking or any type of computer work. Even 1.5 million years ago, when I was a hardcore systems admin kind of person, I was thinking about more than just, you know, my work ended at the screen and the keyboard. I was thinking about how what I was doing was going to impact people's lives and make their jobs easier and all these other kind of things that I think we're always looking at the human aspect of the technology and not just the technology for the sake of having a gadget to play with. And I see that a lot with you as well. And I think you talked recently about using the word human a lot in what you describe that you do. I'm going to jump around here, so I'm going to jump way to the recent. So,
okay.
Do you want to talk to me about that? Like, why do you think it's so important to keep the human in all this business that we do online?
Well, because we are human beings, and we are playing with machines in ways that I don't think most of us understand the impact of that on our lives, on our psyches, on our spirit, on our environment. I am personally very concerned, even as I'm incredibly enthusiastic about technology. I have a 5-year-old daughter. She has been using my iPhone, not to make phone calls, but for just about everything else, since she was almost 2. That is completely different from how I grew up, and to watch how she sees the world and interacts with the world, how she spends time, how she wants to be entertained, everything is affected by the fact that she's been using digital technology from a very early age. Mm-hmm. So I think becoming a parent has made it much more obvious to me. But also, approaching technology from a non-technologist standpoint is a very different place and space to be. And I feel that there is definitely value there. I can relate to programmers. I can speak a little programmese. But it's really about the impact on our lives. It affects our life, our work, everything. And so I just don't want us to forget that. And I think we tend to, because we get so caught up. I'm currently very caught up in Pinterest.
Oh, we need to be talking about that soon, too.
Okay. There's always something new and something more. And I just feel, depending on the kind of person you are, you can become very compulsive about it. It can interfere with so many things. And again, physically, our bodies are affected. We're getting the texting neck because we're looking down at our phones.
Here's my heat pack.
There you go. So, yeah. We're tolerating it. So I think that part of what I'm hoping to do in these next years is to bring a lot of this to the fore, to have the conversations about it, to think about alternative ways of looking at how we're operating with our technology. It's there. I am not a Luddite. I will not reject it. I'm not going to take my computer out into the backyard and smash it with a sledgehammer. I'm not. This is my lifeblood. Since the early 90s, I have had... You know, I've made a living off of all of this, and I've had opportunities that I never would have had if it wasn't for the internet. So I am not saying throw it out, but I'm saying let's reevaluate how we use all of this. Let's try to use it efficiently and effectively and not let it rule our lives. I know a lot of women who are giving up Facebook or giving up Twitter or giving up blogging because they are so overwhelmed. We have many things as women. We have many, many things going on in our lives. We take a lot on. We try so hard to be perfect. And that kind of burden, something's got to give. So rather than giving up a tool that can be valuable, how can we make sure these things that we're using are valuable? And then how can we be okay with paring away and cutting out the things that aren't? So those are the kinds of things I've been exploring a lot myself, and I'm sharing the conversation with others.
Very cool. Very cool. So now I'm actually going to bounce back because you started as a writer, basically wanting an electronic keyboard, a typewriter, And now you're to this point where you're looking at the integration and the balance between technology and people and the uses for each back and forth. Where in the middle did it switch from the, you know, I need a place to type out my thoughts to starting your first business online that, from what you can tell, you were the first, you know, women-owned, women-started internet business? I mean, was that based around your writing, or did you make the switch somewhere in the middle?
Well, I have had an interesting, eclectic career or series of careers. So when I first bought my computer to type up my manuscripts of stories I had been writing for many, many years, I was in the music business. So I was living in Manhattan. I was in the music business. I first worked at ICM, and then I went on to work for the management company for Metallica and Def Leppard. And so that was my space. That's where I was. And this was truly, the internet was my little hobby, my little secret hobby. And I tried to integrate it into the work I did. I tried to use, early on, I tried to use email to send messages and send press agendas to the tour managers for Metallica and Def Leppard. And it kind of worked and it kind of didn't. And so I was starting to use it for work. Well, then I took a new job and I ran a nonprofit organization on domestic violence awareness. So part of my hobby became putting up information about women's issues on the internet. Around the same time, I also read my very first Ms. magazine. And I was fascinated by all of the issues that I had never been able to articulate when I was in the music business as a young woman in an extremely misogynistic business during the heavy metal days, which sort of upped the ante. So the internet was still this little side thing that I was doing, but this time I put up something called Safety Net Domestic Violence Resources. It was the first collection of domestic violence information on the internet, and I was starting to get emails from around the world from people thanking me for having put this up because they never had access to this information any other way. So that, again, was going on. And what actually happened is I was held up at gunpoint with a friend, and we were taken against our will to a bank to take money out. And it was a 15-minute ordeal that changed my life and changed the way I looked at my life and what I did with my life. And I ended up quitting my job and deciding to start a business. And that was mostly out of the sort of feeling that I didn't want to let life pass me by and not pursue some of my own ideas and my own dreams. It wasn't that I really wanted to start a business because I knew nothing about it and I had no money in the bank. I mean, you're living in New York City and in the 90s. And
yeah, and left, you left on the Upper East, you don't have any money.
yeah, no money at all. So it was out of necessity. It was just, I had to do something. And then I thought, well, what do I do? I write. What else do I do? I know about the internet. And then while I was recovering from being held up, I mean, I wasn't injured, but I was obviously psychically pretty traumatized. I had post-traumatic stress disorder for quite a while. And I went to Santa Fe, New Mexico to visit my sister, and I saw an ad in the paper to discover the World Wide Web. And I had no idea at the time what it was. This was 1994. And I saw an email address, so I knew email, and I emailed and found out that there was a one-hour class for $10 in basic HTML. And now I say it, and I'm like, yeah, of course, whatever. But back then, it was like, whoa, what is this stuff? So that's what I did. I took this course in HTML, and suddenly I was a web designer, and went back to New York City and basically pounded the pavement and went to all these different businesses to find out if they were interested in having a website, and they all said no. I went to the MoMA, Museum of Modern Art, and in that meeting, they turned to my boyfriend at the time, who had carried the computer in for me, and asked him all the questions. Even though I set up the computer, I did the whole presentation, and then as soon as I said any questions, they turned to him in the corner of the room and started addressing him. So that was interesting. The Met, I met with the Met. I met with a whole lot of other companies and organizations and institutions that I thought they should have a website, and they all said no.
So the lesson here is when you come walking in for a meeting, they should really say yes to you from now on.
Oh, oh gosh. You know, it was so early on, nobody had any idea. And finally, the way I got my very first client, my first paying client, was I was friends with some PR gals from the domestic violence days, and one of them worked at PT & Co., Patrice Tanaka & Company, and I went in to show them what the web was. They had asked if I would set them up on America Online. I said, well, why do you want to be there? You should be on the web. I ended up helping their client, Avon Products, put Avon's breast cancer awareness crusade onto the web and onto America Online. And that was the beginning of this wonderful relationship with this company, which was also a woman-led company. Patrice Tanaka became one of my mentors early on, actually my only female mentor at the time. And that is what kick-started an actual business. And then I targeted other companies looking to reach women. I was approached by Clinique, and we did Origin's first website. So it snowballed from there. But it was a very interesting time because I had no idea that it was this moment in history. Mm. To me, it was this moment in my life where my whole life had changed, and I just wanted to start something new. And I loved it. I loved every minute of building this thing. What I didn't love was running a business. It was definitely not my personality.
That's a really hard thing as, you know, a freelancer or a solopreneur or a small business, whatever. I mean, I know a couple people that have family businesses. They're basically four or five related entrepreneurs, you know, that work together, freelancers that work together, and they kind of cobble together a business. But yeah, when you have a particular strength or a passion or talents, and then you have to do like bookkeeping or you know,
managing other people. Managing, I was the worst manager in the world. I really was. I was horrible.
I was okay until I had to do something mean, you know, like I was like, oh, like, really?
Yeah, when I had to fire somebody, I almost started to cry, but then she started to be really mean to me. And so I felt all the tears just suck right back up. And I said, you know what, this is why I'm firing this person, because they're not nice. But I can't say that I was extremely nice back then. I was terrified about the business side of it. And I still have always struggled with that kind of, the business side. I really have. I love being independent, and I love being able to work entirely online. In fact, we haven't talked about it yet, but I live in rural Alaska. I'm coming to you live from the crossroads of the Alaska Highway, 90 miles from the Canadian border.
Wow.
And so the fact that I can do this and appear to be everywhere from almost the middle of nowhere, in a sense, so far away, I think is miraculous. And that's what I love. I love this very much. But the business side to me is a means to an end. Mm-hmm. The creative side, the connecting, the community building, the going out and teaching and speaking, I love that part a lot.
Yeah, I was going to say, those are a lot of my favorite things, too. I keep shifting. I'm sitting all day in my chair. the things that I love is, for a while, just because of the experience and talents that I have, I wound up doing a favor for someone and working in a corporate environment for like 6 months as a consultant, and I switched over all of their instructor-led training to, you know, this internet stuff. They're like, we just need it to be on the internet like a TV show. And I was like, okay, I think I know what you mean. Like, I get what you're saying there. But I kind of got a strong taste for teaching then as well, too, and not just speaking or doing that sort of thing, but actually working people through and writing curriculum and stuff like that. So I could see how you would be drawn to that as a mechanism to work and part of what you like to do, and not just spew your knowledge out, but actually work people through reaching the points themselves with whatever they need to find out from you, whatever knowledge that you have that you're teaching. So part of the thing that interests me is, I wanted to talk to you because, like I said, we were talking kind of before we turned this live on air, is I see you at conferences and you do these amazing talks, and I wanted to talk a little bit about kind of your position on that and the talks. The one that we were chatting about before we went live was a talk that you did at Blogworld in Los Angeles. I guess it was 2011, with Jill Foster. And so can you just, because that, the idea of that and what the two of you talked about resonated with me so much based on my history of working with women and mentoring women when I didn't realize that's what I was doing and finding your voice. So I'm curious if you talk to us a little bit about that.
Well, first of all, I love Jill Foster. She is an amazing energy, and I'm very, very lucky and blessed to have been able to work with her. It happened a little bit, I don't want to say by accident, but initially I was approached by Deb Ing, who is also fantastic. She does the community for Blogworld, and she's part of a group that I had put together called Chain of Daisies, which is a small group of women who are speakers or aspiring speakers, and we just help each other find opportunities, help each other find our voices, a little encouragement, lots of discussion about women in business, women's issues, and women speakers. So Deb had encouraged me to submit a proposal to speak at Blogworld, and she asked me about doing something for women like finding their voice, something to help encourage other women specifically to submit proposals to Blogworld so they could have more female speakers. Because Rick and Dave and everybody over there, Patty, they're all really cognizant of the fact that there was always a lot more men than women, and we're working very, very hard to make a change. So all this came together. Here I was trying to bring women together who were speakers to help us help each other. And here was a conference that really, truly wanted to help encourage women. So this finding our voice came out of a chapter in a book I wrote called Power Tools for Women in Business. And it's about the power of women's storytelling and how we as women must tell our stories. Through it, we encourage and empower other women, other people in general, and we ourselves, through the telling of our stories, will find greater strength, greater insight, more support. So it's just this mutually beneficial thing to do, to tell your story. And so that is what the Finding Our Voices was all about. It started off with me doing a little intro about how we need to listen to the positives and not the negatives, whether it's our inner voice or the voices around us, that as women we absorb a lot of negativity from everyone else, and then we play these negative tapes inside our head which hold us back, including from submitting proposals to speak at events. And I play those tapes in my head, and I have to cut them out. So that's how this workshop started, and then we went on to this 15-20-minute dynamic pep talk from Jill, and then I went through four steps to get women to think about what are the topics that I talk about, what I feel passionate about, what are my topics, and then what are the titles that I could come up with to encapsulate those topics, what are my three key points that I want to share with people, and then why should it be me, why am I the one to speak about this topic, and then we worked through with other women in the audience these steps and helped them hone their messages and find that voice. And some of these women went on to submit not just to Blogworld, but to other conferences as well. And we keep hearing back from them saying that they took what they learned and what they gained from the session, and they're turning it into a speaking career. So, yes.
Wow. That is, I was going to say, part of what I like when, you know, you and I, along with a lot of other people that choose to live inside the internet, tend to offer a lot of stories and advice and I just
and honesty too, though. And honesty.
Yeah, there's a lot of honesty that goes on. I mean, it's not all about putting things out there that are just, you know, the pretty fluffy things. I mean, sometimes you kind of gotta not dish out the really bad stuff, but you gotta say it's not always sunny, you know, kind of thing. But it's nice to hear those stories back, because every once in a while it feels like I'm just, you know, just like in the beginning, you're talking and you don't realize there's somebody really on the other side of that screen, you know, popping up. Hey, do you want to chat? It's so for you to actually get that feedback from these women saying, you know, hey, because basically what I hear from that is, hey, I listened and paid attention and found value in what you were speaking about, and I applied it because you made it easy to do so, and I was successful, and thank you. And I just think that's amazing. And something that we don't, I feel, do enough is pat each other on the back. You know, sports players, and I won't even say a gender thing, but sports players, it seems ingrained in them to kind of cheer their teammates on.
Mm.
And
yeah.
We don't do that. We
and what do you think? Why do you think
solo.
We don't, though? Yeah, why do you think, though? Why do you think we don't do that?
I think there's some inherent sense of competition.
But competition can be good, so...
And I'm not a competitive person, so I'm like, you know, I shy back from it, but, well, right, it depends, right. Competitive. Sometimes I am. But not usually professionally. I'm not real, you know, I don't view myself as being that way. But I see a lot of women go through the same things that you just described, and what I hear them say is that they're afraid of the competition, and not that they're afraid of the competition, but that they're afraid that, say, they'll submit and fail or not get picked or they're not good enough. So
well, there's a lot of, yeah, that's a lot of things that are going on. That's a lot of things that are going on. One thing that I think, and tell me what you think of this, that a lot of women come from a scarcity, a place of scarcity, as opposed to a place of abundance. So if you get that, then there's going to be less for me. So that's why they're not supportive of each other. Then they also come from this negative internal place that they're not worthy enough, and I battle with this a lot. People don't even believe me. Like when you say that you're shy, and I'm like, no, you're not shy. I have struggled with confidence issues, self-esteem, many, many years, and it manifests in a lot of different ways. But one of the things, when I go to submit a proposal for speaking engagement, and I love speaking, I love, 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 I hate writing proposals. I hate filling out forms. And I hate writing proposals to speak.
And are you because like, can't I just talk to you on the phone?
Right. I could tell you why I should speak. And I'm a writer, so I'm struggling with something that it has nothing to do with the inability to put my words down on paper. But I have a block. I just don't think that what I have to say is going to be interesting enough when I put it down on paper. I've written 9 books. I've had 6 publishers, 6 different publishers. Several have published me more than once. You publish books, so it's not that I can't write. But it's that moment of putting yourself out there and saying, here are my ideas, and here's why I should be the one to speak. And right now, I've got these book proposals I'm supposed to be writing, and I still struggle with that. I mean, 9 books. And I had an editor come to me and say, I'd love a book proposal from you. And I think, well, what do I have to say? What do I have to say that's interesting that people are going to want to hear about? It continues to happen. And so it's just a constant lesson, learning. We've got to encourage each other. And again, when you give that, you get that back. You encourage other people. Eventually, to me, when I hear a woman say, thank you so much for that workshop, it has totally changed my life. It's the same thing when I first was online with Cybergrrl. Thank you so much for teaching me how to do this. It's totally changing my life. That's the fuel. That's the thing that's going to keep me going. We have to encourage ourselves, we have to encourage each other, and not mock people to admit to feeling weaker, lesser than, but to let them know that they're fine, they're okay. I've had a lot of people attack me for, and I don't know if you've ever seen that, but for putting your vulnerabilities out there. some people get very mad about that. And the way that I deal with that is I think, you know, they must have a lot of fears themselves, and I'm just bringing them up, and so they're going to have to, like, shoot me down.
I had this thing when I first saw you chatting the other day with Jill. There was a comment thread, and I saw the two of you were commenting, and I was like, oh, here's my chance. I'm going to grab one of them. And so I was like, okay, she said yes, she'll come on, and we'll have a conversation. It'll be great. And then that rolled into the whole idea of me attending South by Southwest this year, and I was like, okay, now I'm staring at all of these fears. And I don't know if I've mentioned it on the live broadcast, but I had said it a little bit before, and I've said it, you know, typed out someplace on a comment that I was, you know, I've seen you a couple places, and I was always kind of nervous to come up to you because you were always, like, smiling and having this great time, and you were always surrounded by all these people, and it seemed like this group, and it didn't seem like I could break into the group. So I was like, okay, maybe next time. And then, you know, next time's a year and a half later, you know, by the time you get there.
My gosh.
But this fear about admitting that, and then I started having these conversations online, and I was like, wow, I just put all of these goofy, quirky, stupid things that go on in my head, you know, that self-talk, like you were saying, that tape playing online on public. And now I look like a dork and people are going to make fun of me. I'm like, should I go back and delete it? I'm like, what do I do? But, yeah, I mean, I think you're right. A lot of the, you know, my gut reaction was, you know, people are going to call me out on this. People are going to call it out for being different, to say, no, Lynette, you say that everybody's probably shy, but no, you're really the only one. So it's a hard thing, and I see a lot of women specifically in the context of their professional life, if they're in any sort of technology or any sort of male-dominated industry, or their interactions on social media, if it's not perfect or if it's not scrubbed and it's not pristine, it's not like the final edit when it goes out and it doesn't demonstrate this, you know, perfect, happy life that they don't want it out there. Now, the mom bloggers have definitely broken out of that as large genre. And then within that, there's millions of different, you know, subgenres of that. But that was the first thing. And I've never considered myself a mom blogger, but I gravitate to reading them because they are willing to put it out online and become that tribe with each other and say, okay, like, I had a really junky day, and, you know, my boss was an idiot, or, you know, my husband came home in a bad mood, and my kid puked on me, like, all of this, and they're willing to put it out. It's like, really? You could talk about that stuff publicly? You're okay with that? And the whole life balance, the whole life-work balance of being a mom. And I think you may have written something around that.
Oh, I write that it's not a balance, it's a juggle. If you try to strive for balance, the myth, and this is what Danielle Smith and I talk about in Mom Incorporated, that we're putting these bars so high up for ourselves, and then they keep getting moved higher and higher, and we never attain that. But wait, I have to go back. Okay, so here. Starting from what you first started
like
to say.
I just like your juggle versus the balance thing.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah, then thank you. It's we're very much against the word balance. But first of all, you saw me at places and I was laughing and smiling and surrounded by people. It's because I wear a pink boa and a pink tiara, and I do this. People have criticized me for doing that as well. They think it's setting women back or something. I found that when I first did it, people smiled at me as opposed to look past me. And I would make people smile just by having this on. Then they'd come up and talk to me as opposed to me standing in the corner by myself and not having the courage to approach other people. So it became an icebreaker in that way. I now have it as my signature, plus it's easier to say, look for the girl in the pink tiara, or the woman in the pink tiara and boa, as opposed to look for the woman with graying hair. Well, then again, that is a little bit of a rarity, too, and I probably would like to address that issue in terms of ageism in our industry. But
horrible. We do need to talk about that.
Yeah. So, but I wanted to say that It's like the popular girl syndrome. In high school, I remember looking at the popular girl and thinking, oh, what a great life she had. Look at all her friends. She would never say anything to me. If I went up there, they would all just laugh at me. So I never would go up and talk to them. And then I meet them later through Facebook, of course, because we're connecting with all of our high school friends, and found out that they were incredibly lonely. Incredibly lonely. And so it's kind of that thing that people perceive, how we perceive each other. I've been looking at what you've been doing, watching what you do with the women of G Plus, and thought, oh my gosh, that's brilliant. This woman is so cool.
I'm a
Never
dork.
thinking that I could approach you. Well, this is awesome that we're both dorks. But that's the guys, they don't usually think this way. And if we have any guys watching, hi guys. They don't. They aren't brought up to. I don't think it's genetic in them. They are just, everyone's sort of there, and the world is there, and everything's great and fine, and they're not stressing in that kind of way. Maybe they will about approaching somebody they like, but
Oh,
that's
yeah, if they have to
different.
talk to, quote unquote, a girl that they like, I think that's probably more difficult. But in a professional or a non-mate,
So not a non-social way.
I have to find a mate in my life situation, that kind of thing.
Right. And so and but women, we do play these head games with ourselves. And so here I was, really intimidated by you. And then when you entered in this conversation, this comment thing yesterday on Google Plus, I'm thinking, "Oh my God. Oh my God. She's talking to me." And then we said that I could come on to your show sometime. I'm like, I better jump on that right now or else she'll change her mind. Seriously. I mean, we got to get over ourselves. This is just not productive. So, totally cool. It's great to meet you and get to know you. I
I know,
can't wait
I'm.
to.
You're all the way. You're so far left coast. You're not even left coast.
Oh,
You're
I thought you were
west
going to say
west
I'm like a
coast.
lefty.
No. And I'm like all the way. I'm in New Jersey. I'm all the way, a little south of Manhattan. So yeah, I mean, this is how many thousands of miles? So
Thousands of
thousands
miles.
of miles.
Well,
And
okay, so the thing is the popular girl syndrome, had to bring that up. The mom blogger thing also, that's my first entree into being really self-confessional and putting it all out there. And I have a mommy blog, which I don't pay as much attention to anymore, but it started off as a miscarriage blog. And I blogged very candidly about the physical things that were going on in my life as I was losing these pregnancies. My 5-year-old daughter was my fifth pregnancy, so I documented everything and put it all out there. And that was another way of me connecting with other women and helping other women because nobody else would talk about this stuff back then. So I totally agree that that whole mom blogger space, those women are brave. And I
they
have to
are.
say
They
that
really
once you have a
are.
baby, you kind of, or trying to have a baby,
Trying, yeah, even to that point, yeah.
it breaks down a lot of the barriers. So I was just relating to all the things that you were telling me, but I had to let you know that the feeling was mutual. And next time you see me at a place, you better walk up and say something to me, because half the time I may just be smiling, but nobody's talking to me. They're just looking at my tiara and boa and then walking away. So, yeah, please come and say hello.
Deal.
Awesome.
Absolute deal. I guess something else that I wanted to talk about is the whole, like you said, no balance. So okay, juggle.
Yeah.
How do you, because you are, I'll say a fairly new mom, because you said your daughter's 5.
Five, yeah.
My kids are 4 and 10. And so, I haven't hit the teenage years yet, thank goodness, but it's different every year. How are
Sure.
you, because your career existed before you widened your family.
Yeah.
So how
Before I
is,
got married. I got married
okay,
late. I
that's
got married
true,
at
okay.
38. Yeah.
So how did this all, wait, was your boyfriend that was carrying the computers in and out, is that your husband now, or was it somebody else?
No,
That was a different
that
one,
isn't.
okay.
That was, yeah, that was a 10-year relationship, and then I ended up moving. It didn't work out, but no, this is a very unexpected thing for me, because I was at the stage in my life where I said, I'm not getting married. Marriage is just some strange, antiquated institution that will probably ruin the relationship that I have if I find a good relationship. And I was against it. And then met this amazing man. And I, quick journey, I was in New York City for 13 years, but my last year before I fully moved away from New York, I bought an RV that I found on the internet and drove around the country for a year by myself. And you can actually see my travels on rvgrrl.com. It's still there. It's a little, it's an old-fashioned, hand-coded HTML site, but I hadn't learned about blogs and blogging yet, so I did everything completely by hand. So that was this year of travel, and that's when I ended up breaking up with the boyfriend in New York and starting new in Wyoming, because on my way home, it was September 11th, and at that stage, New York was no longer my home. I was afraid to go back, and so I moved to Wyoming. I met a man from Montana. He got a job in Alaska, and he married me to make sure that I moved up here. I told him, I'll follow you anywhere to the ends of the earth. I'm just about there. And thank goodness for the internet. So I'm a late bloomer.
Now? How? Hmm? Because you are a very whole, independent woman. You jumped in an RV, for God's sakes, and drove across the country by yourself, and now you have a family. You have a husband and a child, and how does this fit into your life, and how does it fit into your career?
Really, really hard struggle. It's been a very, very hard and painful struggle. But I have this amazing husband who, for a while, he thought he was getting the stay-at-home mom. Where did he get that idea? I finally said, you know, before we met, I was traveling the world, speaking and writing books and starting and running businesses. So it may not change. And it's not an easy thing. But I was just talking to him the other night. I said, you know, honey, it's so interesting because when you used to resist having me go out and speak or, you know, leaving town and doing the things that I do or being on the computer a little bit longer than I should, I would get so, you know, frustrated and angry about it, and that would cause us to butt heads. I said, but honey, the day that you said to me, okay, hon, whatever you want to do, that's fine. It's the day that I freaked out and I didn't want to leave home anymore. So now I've come to the place to understand that it is very hard. It is incredibly, and guys have this too. I mean, I know I've had conversations with CC Chapman about this, and Mitch Joel recently. I ran into him in Frankfurt, Germany, and he's very vocal about the importance of family and being there to put his kids to bed at night.
Yeah, Mitch is somebody that, you know, the last time I talked to him and saw him, he was like, he doesn't like to be away from home for more than two nights in a row.
Exactly.
And I mean, and Germany, I'm sure, was an exception, obviously, from
here. Well, he was in and out of there. I mean, yeah. I didn't even have a chance to sit down with him and really talk, because I've wanted to connect with him for quite a long time. But that's because he is adamant about this. And you have more power to him. I think it's great. I personally like to extend my trip a little bit, because it's very hard to get out of Alaska, first of all, and then to get anywhere else in the country or the world. But also, it's that moment where I can just breathe and be my other self. I don't want to neglect that other self, the creative, the speaker, the teacher. And so I recharge that way. And then I come back here to a very tiny community where in the winters, this long, dark winters, cold, freezing cold, like 45 below. So I can't say that there is any formula. What it really has boiled down to, and this is also something Danielle Smith and I have written in Mom Incorporated, is open communications. If my husband and I hadn't talked about this, I don't think we could be together. But we just talked about what we needed, what we wanted, what we expected, and we're finding that middle ground. We've been married now, I guess, 7, 8 years. It's important. The communication piece of it is incredibly important. But you can't give yourself up. And that's what I said to him as well. I said, you wouldn't love me if I was not me. You know, so this is a piece of me, and I have to live that out. And he's a hunter. He goes hunting, and he'll go hunting for weeks on end. And I'm like, cool. That's what you do. And that's awesome.
Like,
and I will not change him.
Hunter or
like what?
He's professionally a hunter, or he's
no,
a,
no.
He really, they have that.
No, he hunts. He goes hunting, and we eat the meat that he hunts. He fills our freezer with moose and caribou and mountain goat and sheep, and that's life in Alaska. That's life with a mountain man.
Ooh,
so
that
yeah, so I think that anyone who looks like they've got it all together and they have it all or that it's perfect, it's a facade. We have these perceptions of people and we have no idea what's behind all of what we see. We want to project our best face and our best image, but I feel that there's value in being honest as well, because that perfection, not there. That balance, not there. Right now, I said to my husband, I've got this thing. It's live. It's video. It's like around the time you come home from work. Can you keep the little one quiet? You know, it's the give and the take. So I help him when he's going off to hike for 8 hours, which he considers fun. Then I hang out with the five-year-old. So, yeah, I think that we put a lot of pressure on ourselves to get it all right. Just get through it. Just get through it with grace and with patience and with love and with respect. It's the best we can do.
Yeah, so we have to remind ourselves of that every day, I think, because it's so easy to lose sight of.
Yeah.
So easy. So I want to ask you, before we wrap up, what's next for you? What is a thing that you've got a little fire burning, you want to crank up, and what's the thing that you really, really, really want to do next?
Well, I have, in a sense, been asking the universe that. I keep putting it out there. What should I be doing? I keep gravitating toward writing more in an instructional and how-to way to guide people. Again, my core theme is, how do we take this technology that has done amazing and incredible things and a lot of unbearable things to our lives and get good use out of it? If I can help somebody get inspired or motivated to do something, I feel like I'm doing a good job. I'm doing my work. I would love to work on another book. I'm getting into teleseminars, and I want to start doing some live webinars as well. I think I'm a content girl. I like taking words and putting them down in a manageable way that people can go through and get something out of it and do something with it. That's amazing that people can act on your words in a positive way. Mm. So what's next for me? I ask all of you, what is next for me? Where should I go? What should I do? I'm blessed to have a couple of really great, creative, interesting clients. And that takes care of the money side so I can pay the bills. And the rest of it is gravy. I want to be able to put my creativity and energy toward good work. So I put it out there, and maybe somebody watching will say, gosh, we could really use her help. That would be wonderful. What's next for you? What are you going to do with this Women of G+? I mean, this is a great project.
Actually, the idea of it came about when Google Plus first opened up, and it was called a sausage fest. Because there were no women, or there were perceived to be no women in here.
Yeah.
And I'm like,
yeah,
over in the corner, a whole bunch of us going, hey, we're here, you know. There are girls that understand this. And there was this whole inappropriate rant by people that honestly didn't know which side of the body they were talking out of, about how women didn't understand. It was too technical, too difficult. That's why the girls weren't here.
So I was on at that time, too. And G+ is easy.
Yeah, I'm like, it's really not that hard. It took me 6 minutes to hit every button I could find, and then, okay, what do you do next, right?
Yeah.
You do something different. And what I decided to do with this, rather than every other social platform I'm on, is I wanted to do exactly what you're talking about, that kind of bring a community together to help support each other and find each other and acknowledge each other. But I was drawn to the tools that are available, you know, the actual, you know, the hangouts and the way that things are shared and the mechanics of the system as well. So that's what kind of drew that me to this. Because a lot of what I've wound up doing over the course of my career, and I've been working as a professional for about 23 years, half of that time, no, less than half, that, since about 2000, I've been out of corporations. I left the corporate life around then. And I realized that I was this unofficial mentor towards women. They're like, well, you do this. Can you help me? Or can I talk to you about some things? Because there are so few of us in that space that when you find somebody, you're like hanging on to their leg kind of thing. So I wanted to do that space here because I was seeing early on that there were women that would come in and would see it was like, the best thing I could kind of think about from the outside is maybe it looked like Animal House in here, depending on where you went, or it looked like there was nobody here. And I loved the idea of this platform. And it runs a little counter to how I am professionally. I think you should be platform agnostic. You should do what the right solution is. But I liked this for whatever reasons. I was drawn to it. And I wanted to make sure that other people weren't getting misinformation or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I just liked the idea of banding together. And I wanted to show that you didn't have to be a tech to behave or live in a technical world, if that's how people look at it. You know, I've met people that are women that are high officers in the United States Coast Guard. I've met people that work for the space. They work down in Cape Canaveral. Women that work down there for the space shuttle launches and stuff like that. And it's like, no, you don't have to be a quote unquote traditional coding geek to get this. So that's what kind of drew me to this. And I figured, well, all right, I'm going to finally do the things that I say or that I was doing in the past, but in a more official capacity. So that's that. But
I think it's great. I think it's great.
So what are you coming like to the lower 48? What are you doing? Do you have plans?
Oh, yeah.
For the next year? What are you doing? I want to know.
Yeah, well, the one of the things about dealing with being so far away and the whole issue of the juggle is I've decided every month I will get out. Up here in Alaska, we say we go outside, which means we go outside of Alaska. So I was just in February this past month, I was just in Napa for the Wine Sisterhood Gathering with one of my clients, and I spoke there about social mobile applications and also led a little workshop about telling our stories. And then this month, I'm going to Hawaii with my family. And next month, that's instead of South by Southwest. That's you make your decisions and choices. Everyone's like, how can you not go to South by Southwest? Because I'm going to Hawaii with my family, of course. In April, I'm speaking with Danielle Smith on our book, Mom Incorporated, at Retreat Yourself. I want to say retweet. Retreat Yourself, which is a retreat in Leesburg, Virginia, put on by Stacey Ferguson, who's Justice Fergie from Blogalicious. And that's happening in April 13th and 14th. And then in May, I'm keynoting SheCon. Julie Wahlberg organizes that. She and her husband organize that. And it's a wonderful women blogger type of event. So that's happening in May. And then once the summer hits, I kind of don't like leaving Alaska, but I think I have a few other things planned for June and July. I'm also on the board of Life Center Northwest, so I will be going to some board retreats and meetings and things like that. That takes me to Bellevue, Washington, but that's an organ donation nonprofit organization, so I work with them. So things get me out of Alaska.
I see that. I bet Alaska in the summer is probably nice. I don't
it's
really
gorgeous.
Think I could deal with it in February. I'm sorry.
No, it's not easy. I'm hoping my husband has lit the wood stove to heat up the house. I tried to do it earlier and did not succeed, so I'm looking forward to the toasty warm fire.
Good, good. Well, I will wrap this up. I will let you go. I'm sure it's like a little after 10 p.m. my time, which means my kids are probably standing outside the door sneaking when they're supposed to be sleeping. But we'll wrap this up, and I will definitely
Okay.
have to catch up with you later, and I promise not to be so shy when it comes to you anymore. And hopefully we bump into each other soon.
Absolutely. Let's do. Let's do. There's a lot of great events coming up, and maybe I'll end up at a few, and our paths will cross. And yes, we will say hello.
Okay, it's a deal. All right. So, for anybody that's watching this live, I will put this down on YouTube tomorrow, and I will send out the links, and you'll be able to watch it. Except for my false start in the beginning, where I kept pronouncing your name incorrectly, so I'll cut that part out. You won't be so bad, I promise. Okay, I'm gonna close out this hangout, and then everything's gonna go away, but I will catch you very soon online. Thank you so much for doing this for me.
Thank you. Thank
It
you very
really was
much.
really was an honor, and I'm sorry that I had to be so goofy and so nervous, so.
Like I said, we're both goofy. It's totally cool.
All right.
Okay. Take care.
Good
Bye.
night.
Good night.